Hello students, welcome to the session. We are discussing forensic medicine and we are talking about medical law and ethics. So we'll talk about what are the duties of medical practitioners. So what are the responsibilities, what are the duties of medical practitioners, right? So the duty to exercise reasonable degree of skill and knowledge is what is expected out of a medical practitioner. So as soon as the doctor accepts the patient and starts giving advice, the duty arises, because there is a physician-patient relationships which gets established, and once that happens, whatever advice is given, which would help the life of the patient, which would be to promote health. So all this would necessitate that the doctors actually exercise a reasonable degree of care, and they exercise their skill and knowledge according to the terms and standards of their ethics. Right, they have to follow. So that refers to exercising reasonable degree of skill and knowledge. Once even phone conversations where they provide consultation, once they start giving advice regarding the patient's health, or they may ask about the symptoms, or they may start performing clinical examination, taking the consent of the patient, all this establishes that physician-patient relationship, and that leads to the doctor to establish a reasonable degree of care and skill and knowledge when it comes to treating the patient. Duties with regard to attendance and examination. So the doctors are supposed to, they are obliged to attend the case as long as it is required. So depending on the patient's condition, they are supposed to provide their services for as long as needed. And only when they know that the patient is malingering or withholding certain important information, or the patient may be taking consultation from another doctor without informing the first doctor, or the doctor themselves may fall sick. And in those cases, they will have to inform the patient and withdraw their services. Or if the patient is not in a financial position to provide fees to the doctor, in those conditions also the doctor may stop their services. But however, if these conditions are not present, the doctor has every responsibility to attend the case of the patient as long as it is required, as well as even do the follow-up whenever it is necessary. Duty to furnish proper and suitable medicines. Now this applies to allopathy doctors who can prescribe medication and who will have to prescribe the dosage of the drugs. So if the doctor owns a dispensary, they can write a legible. They will have to furnish the prescription, and that would make it possible for the patient to provide to obtain the medication, and they will have to follow up the patient on the medication which they have to take, right? Duty to give instructions. So whatever instructions are necessary must be provided to the patient when it comes to the use of the medicines. So, or if it is a nutritionist, so they may advise the patient to go on a particular diet depending on the patient's condition. So all that must be given. Depending on the lifestyle of the patient, they will have to advise them. Duty to control and warn. There is something called reasonable foreseeability. The doctor is supposed to warn the patient about the possible side effects of a drug, or the possible reasonable foreseeability means the doctor should have the ability to look into the future and see what kind of side effects or what kind of repercussions may happen because of the treatment or modality which is applied in the patient's case. I'll give you an example. If it is a bus driver, and let's say they suffer from color blindness or they suffer from epilepsy, so the doctor has to, once they know the patient's condition, they will have to warn them, and they will have to they'll have to ask them to change their profession, or they'll have to talk to them. So that is a duty to control and warn. Duty to third parties to protect potential victims. So the same example which I provided, the bus driver who suffers from color blindness or epilepsy or some other condition, such that they may be a liability to others, they may put other people's lives at risk. So when it comes to that also, they'll have to inform the employer, or they may have to inform the party which is responsible for employing this particular person, the patient, such that they protect the lives of the public at large. So that is one thing. Duty towards children and adults who are incapable of taking care of themselves. So there are certain people who suffer from insanity, they may be suffering from a psychological illness, they may be minors or children. So in those conditions, the doctor has to be extra careful and provide proper services such that they protect the lives of the people. Special precautions need to be taken to prevent accidents or harm, because the children and the children who are incapable of taking care of themselves, they require the attention, they require the they have to take proper precautions to prevent any kind of an accident or harm. There's a duty which the doctor has to inform the patient of the possible risk. So all the relevant facts should be explained, and consent has to be obtained. It is very important to obtain the consent, and only then it becomes applicable that whatever procedure the doctor has asked the patient to follow becomes easy for the patient to do that, right? Duties with regard to operations. So when it comes to prepping the patient for the surgery, when it comes to performing the surgery, or they'll have to be very careful to employ a proper they'll have to follow the procedure, right? And even the post-operative or the rehabilitative care has to be administered properly. So those are the duties with regard to operations. They'll also have to coordinate with other surgeons or paramedical staff when it comes to exercising a reasonable degree of their care and skill. Duties under Geneva Convention. So they have to follow the International Code of Ethics, which is given to the medical practitioners. Duties with regard to consultation. The referring physician may be liable under the doctrine of negligent choice, right? So what is the meaning of this? Now, let's say there's a patient who comes for consultation, and the doctor feels that he will not be able to treat the patient, so they will have to refer them to a substitute competent doctor, right? So that the patient's it is out of the patient's best interest. So however, if that referring physician becomes liable for negligent choice, so that is a possibility. So this is very important. When it comes to consultation, they'll have to decide which is the best option for the patient, and they may be directed to visit a second opinion, or they may be directed to visit another doctor who is competent enough to take that case. Okay, so that is with regard to consultation. Duty which they have with x-ray examination: only when it is mandated an x-ray is supposed to be performed, the procedure has to be explained, and the results have to be told very properly to the patient. Professional secrecy. There's something called confidentiality, or maintaining the secrets. When it comes to, once the patient discloses the facts regarding their health condition, the doctor, they'll have to withhold that, they'll have to protect that sort of information. They're not supposed to give away the information when it comes to, when they're interrogated by third parties, unless there is something called privileged communication. Only in those conditions, confidentiality, it is allowed that they violate the law of confidentiality. Otherwise, they are supposed to practice with confidence, with fidelity or loyalty, and with honesty. The doctor is obliged to keep secret all that is known concerning the patient in the course of the professional work. That is the meaning of professional secrecy. That becomes, once there's a doctor-physician relationship, professional secrecy is supposed to be maintained.